There ain't no grave can hold my body down. There ain't no grave can hold my body down. When I hear that trumpet sound, I'm gonna rise right out of the ground. Ain't no grave can hold my body down.
Today I'm going to read an article I wrote back in 2003. It's concerning the cross of Christ. What we see out there in the world of religion today is not the true cross of Christ. It is venerated, it is worn around the neck, it is used in many different pagan rituals. It's ridiculous what the world of religion portrays the cross of Christ as, which it's a bunch of crap. From what I know and what I see out in the world, it's sick. Okay, so I'm going to start reading here. Happy Tuesday, everybody. I'm here for another show today. So we will get started. I am writing this article to prove from the scriptures that Christ was crucified in the most horrible way, and not like those who put him on the ornate cross of Christendom and make it out to be a thing of beauty. Because as you can see, they wear the crosses with all the jewels and gold and all this other crap. It's a bunch of nonsense. I first want to give you the proper rendering of the word cross from the concordant way. Okay, so it comes from the Greek, and it's stauros. It's a stake or pole, an upright standing stander with no cross piece. So as you can see, what we see today is a cross like this. It is not like that. Christ was crucified like this. He suffocated. It was the most horrible death ever. And he was murdered on that pole or a Roman stake. So he was crucified like this. So if you're hanging like this, you will suffocate. And this is how Christ was crucified. Not on a venerated cross like that. Today's Orthodox ornate cross is the most sickening symbol of pagan worship and finds its roots back to Constantine, when he had a vision of this religious symbol in the sky. It has absolutely nothing to do with that cursed pole that our Lord was impaled on. Christ was crucified on a Roman stake that had no cross piece. He suffocated and died in the most graphic way. Many are blind to the fact that these religious symbols of today are used in gangs, cults, pagan rituals, black arts, Masonic lodges, etc. And all of Orthodox Christianity has adopted this emblem of worship and truly have missed the mark in understanding the true impact of Golgotha. There are many passages of scripture that I would like to bring forth to enlighten this vital topic. In one of these passages, Paul gives a description of the death of Christ in the most profound way. He says, "O foolish Galatians, who has bewitched you, before whose eyes Jesus Christ was graphically crucified?" Galatians chapter 3, verse 1. This really hits home how our Lord was crucified and removes the myth that he was on some fancy gold or jeweled cross that religious and pagan human symbols represent. Here is the whole account of the crucifixion from the book of Matthew. That should prove that this was not a religious ceremony, but a graphic murder of the Son of God, in which he was sent to his death by the deceitful religious priests and elders who conspired and plotted his demise. Okay, so I'm going to read this passage here. It's quite a lengthy one, but it gives you the whole deal of how Christ was crucified from the scriptural point of view. "Now morning coming on, all the chief priests and the elders of the people held a consultation against Jesus, so as to put him to death. And binding him, they led him away and gave him up to Pontius Pilate, the governor. Then Judas, who gives him up, perceiving that he was condemned, regretting, turns back the 30 pieces of silver to the chief priests and elders, saying, 'I sinned in giving up innocent blood.' Yet they said, 'What is it to us? You should be seeing that to that,' and tossing the silver pieces into the temple. He retires and coming away strangles himself." So Judas Iscariot is the one that sold Jesus for 30 pieces of silver. And then when he realized what he had done, he gave it back, and then he went away and hung himself. Now the chief priest, taking the silver pieces, said, "It is not allowed to cast them into the Corban, since it is the price of the blood. Now holding a consultation, they buy with them the field of the potter for a sepulchre for strangers. Wherefore that field was called the field of blood till today. Then was fulfilled that which is declared through Jeremiah the prophet, saying, and they got the 30 silver pieces, the price of the valued one, whom they value from the sons of Israel. And they gave them for the field of the potter, according as the Lord arranges with me. Now Jesus was standing in front of the governor, and the governor inquires of him, saying, you are the king of the Jews. Now Jesus appeared to him, you are saying it. And at his being accused by the chief priests and the elders, he answers nothing. Then Pilate is saying to him, are you not hearing how much they are testifying against you? And he did not answer him, not even with one declaration, so that the governor is marveling very much. Now at the festival, the governor had been accustomed to release one prisoner to the throng, whomever they wanted. Now they had then a notorious prisoner termed Barabbas. At their having gathered then, Pilate said to them, whom are you wanting? I should be releasing to you, Barabbas or Jesus, who is termed Christ. For he was aware that it was because of envy they gave him up. Now at his sitting on the dais, his wife dispatches to him, saying, let there be nothing between you and that just man, for I suffered much today in a trance because of him. Now the chief priests and the elders persuade the throngs that they should be requesting Barabbas, yet should be destroying Jesus. Now answering, the governor said to them, which of the two are you wanting I should be releasing to you? Now they said, Barabbas. Pilate is saying to them, what then shall I be doing with Jesus, who is termed Christ? They are all saying, let him be crucified. Yet the governor averred, what evil does he? Yet they cried exceedingly, saying, let him be crucified. Now Pilate, perceiving that it is benefiting nothing, but rather a tumult is occurring, getting water, washes off his hands in front of the throng, saying, innocent am I of the blood of this just man. You will be seeing to it. And answering, the entire people said, his blood be on us and on our children. Then he releases to them Barabbas. Now whipping Jesus, he gives him over to that he may be crucified. Then the soldiers of the governor, taking Jesus along into the praetorium, gather to him the whole squadron, and stripping him, they place a scarlet mantle about him, and braiding a wreath out of thorns, they place it on his head, and a reed in his right hand, and falling on their knees in front of him, they scoff at him, saying, rejoice, King of the Jews. And spitting on him, they got the reed and beat him on his head. And when they scoff at him, they strip him of the mantle and put his garments on him and led him away to be crucified. Now coming out, they found a Syrian man named Simon. This man they conscript that he should be picking up his cross and coming to the place termed Golgotha, which is termed Skull's Place. They give him wine mixed with a bile to drink, and tasting he does not want to drink. Now crucifying him, they divide his garments, casting the lot, and sitting they kept him there, and they place above his head his charge written, this is Jesus, the King of the Jews. They are being crucified together with him two robbers, one at the right and one at the left. Now those going by blaspheming him, wagging their heads and saying, you are demolishing the temple and building it in 3 days. Save yourself. If you are the Son of God, descend from the cross. Likewise, the chief priests also, with the scribes and elders, scoffing, said, others he saves. Himself he cannot save. If he is the King of the Jews, let him descend now from the cross, and we will believe on him. He has confidence in God. Let him rescue him now, if he wanted him, if he is wanting him. For he said that God's son am I. Now with the same, the robbers also who crucified together with him reproached him. Now from the sixth hour, darkness came over the entire land till the ninth hour. Now about the ninth hour, Jesus exclaimed with a loud voice, saying, Elo, Elo, libo sabachthani. That is, my God, why didst thou forsake me? Now some of those standing there hearing it said that he is summoning Elijah. And immediately one from among them, running and getting a sponge, filling it with vinegar, and sticking it on a reed, give him to drink. Yet the rest said, let be, we may see if Elijah is coming and saving him. Now another, getting a lance head, pierces his side, and out came water and blood. Now Jesus again crying with a loud voice, lets out the spirit. And lo, the curtain of the temple is rent in two from above to the bottom, and the earth quaked, and the rocks are rent. And that was Matthew chapter 27, verse 1 through 51. This account of the death of God's son is given clearly, and make no mistake in understanding that the religious in that day up to the present time had no need of the Christ, and seek to pervert the cross and its significant meaning. Christ paid for the sins of the whole world, past, present, future, on that stake. For there is one God and one mediator of God and mankind, a man, Christ Jesus, who is giving himself a correspondent ransom for all, the testimony in its own eras. 1 Timothy chapter 2, verse 5 and 6. And that is why there can only be reconciliation through his blood, and through him to reconcile all to him, making peace through the blood of his cross, through him, whether those on the earth or those in the heavens. Colossians chapter 1, verse 20. Now my camera is shaking a bit. I noticed that. That's okay. I'm shaking on my leg and I do this, you know, for nervous habit. But that's okay. I'm still reading this article. I'm almost done here. So let's continue. But there is no need to glorify the cross by making it a symbol of religious worship, when it is the object of shame and humiliation. Christ alone is the one to be worshipped and acclaimed as Lord, and he will receive that by every human subject in the eons to come, and when at the consummation God becomes all in all. I pray this article will enlighten and edify those who only see the cross as a religious icon and not what it is supposed to represent. So we know the cross of Christ was never supposed to be venerated and never supposed to be worn around the neck as jewelry. And we see in the churches today that they have them everywhere. Down at the corner here, there's a church that has a great big huge cross like this standing in the front lawn. And it's sick. It's a sick representation of the world of religion and pagan ritualism. And I just want you guys to understand that. So the true meaning of the cross of Christ was never supposed to be like it is today. Grace and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ, and we will see you tomorrow. Happy Tuesday. Have a wonderful day.
There ain't no grave can hold my body down. There ain't no grave can hold my body down. When I hear that trumpet sound, I'm gonna rise right out of the ground. Ain't no grave can hold my body down.